Hi, this is Mariusz Duda from Riverside, and you're listening to Sonic Perspectives.
Hello and welcome to another interview with Sonic Perspectives. My name is Samantha, and today I am joined by Marius of Riverside and many other projects across the musical sphere of progressive and electronic and many more. So I'm really excited to talk about all things musical in your world, but especially Riverside's upcoming album, which is coming out on January 20th. So are you excited? How are you feeling? That's just about 2 weeks away now.
I always answer in this way, like my excitement is together with, feeling sad because this is the end of some journey that I went through all these months, 2022, practically in general. I was working on the new Riverside, and now it's going to the end. I mean, it's great. I'm pretty excited that it will be the beginning of new life. But at the end, I feel sad because this is the end of the process that I adore. So I probably have to do very quickly something else to feel like, I do something for a living. But this part is pretty great. I believe that Riverside recorded a really good album, and that's a good chapter, the new chapter of our third decade. When we wave to people like, hello, we kind of changed, but I think you will accept us.
Well, you do keep yourself very busy, and I'm sure that there will be much more to come after this album. So you released Wasteland in 2018, Lunatic Soul's new album in 2020, your solo album in 2021, and now this. How do you balance all of these projects, especially when you're still touring in between?
That's a good question. I try to divide them into different musical words. That's the thing, Riverside has its own identity. That's the rock band. We play live shows. We interact with the audience during these live shows. And we have these instruments, the basic, drums, bass, guitar, vocal, keyboards. And that's it. Lunatic Soul is somewhere in between, and I really love this because it's my love for the folk music, dark, ambient, electronic stuff, and I use all instruments that I can play on. And this is the studio project, so I don't have to bother with how I will play that live. So I can experiment in a different way. And my electronic experiences that started in pandemia, that's probably something like, okay, I have a collection of many, many instruments. I need to do something with them. So I did something with them. And I just also promised myself maybe one project should be like my escape from, classic standard songs with the first chorus, with this, what you can hear on Riverside's music, on Lunatic Soul music sometimes. So it's pretty experimental, and maybe that's why I decided to record that at the very beginning only on tape cassettes. But each project has its own identity, and I believe thanks to this, I can do some things even separately. I mean, even at the same time, but thanks to this, that they're different, I can still do them.
So, when did you start writing and recording for this latest Riverside album? How long has it been in the works?
In pandemia, when we took a break, I was thinking of the subject for the new Riverside. One day we should come back. And then I thought, okay, maybe that's the subject connected with the identity. Like, who are we these days? Are we still ourselves? Or we pretend someone else? Do we feel okay with that? Do we feel manipulated? Do we feel like there's someone who wants something from us? you know, when there was this pandemic and COVID, when we were sitting in the lockdowns, there was lots of thoughts about who are we these days. I thought that would be a great subject. And then I realized that Riverside, at the beginning of their new journey, because this is the beginning of the third decade of our activity, should be a bit different than in the previous decade. Maybe we should be who we really are. And who we really are, I ask myself a question. I just realized that we shine the most when we play live shows. So I thought maybe we should, this idea was actually when we played Wasteland Tour. I just realized that we should record the album one day, which wouldn't be a live album, but the studio album that reflects this live energy. I really had this at the back of my head. So this identity thing came together with this live approach. And after the celebration of our 20th anniversary, I already knew that these two plots should be on one album. And we started to compose everything at the end of 2021. And after that, we had to go on tour. We were touring United States. And I was cursing that at the very beginning, because we couldn't finish the whole compositions. But I later realized that I needed that live energy very, very much. That was a great tour, a great audience. We had lots of fun. And when we returned from this tour, we just went directly to the studio. So we still were, you know, full of this live energy. And I think that helped very much to record the album. We had only 2.5 months to record that, but we kind of were... We finished that with the satisfaction and went on another tour. So all the in between two tours, we have recorded the new album. But the result is pretty like I imagined at the very beginning, a few years ahead even.
So I read that you approached the writing and recording of this album a bit differently, that you spent a lot of time composing in the rehearsal room rather than going straight to the studio. How do you think that impacted the sound of this album?
Well, I was a producer of this album. And as a producer, I also decided to pay attention to the sound thing, but not only like I'm sitting and using some knobs and things, because these are sound engineers for, but I really wanted to go back to the old Riverside sound, the one that we had at the very first decade of our activity. And because with the previous decade, when we recorded the albums like Shrine of New Generation Slaves, Love in the Time Machine, Wasteland, these songs were composed mainly on studio, and they were like, especially Love, Fear and Wasteland, kind of like my solo albums, you know, that the band helped me to arrange. But I did that in the studio, and later I had sent them lots of files and we did that together, but there was no this band feeling like we are together in the rehearsal room. And so with the new album, I decided we should do more things together in the rehearsal room before we enter the studio. So I was still like, I was hoping for doing more things together also in terms of composing, but at the end I did the most again. But the main difference was that I was sitting at the, let's say in the middle, I had the guys around me and I said, okay, so I've got this riff, let's play this way. Let's play the rhythm a bit slower. Yeah, oh, okay, that way, yeah, great. Let's join with the guitar, let's join with the keyboards, let's see. So I could filter everybody at the same time. And thanks to this, we catch this atmosphere that we had at the very beginning. So we played more like a band. This live approach, as I mentioned before in the previous answer, was really important. And I believe we achieved that. And that was my main goal as a producer, to create this album, like the band sounds like the band that they were rehearsing and they just entered the studio, you know? And that's why we didn't do as many layers as on the previous albums. I didn't want it to create blockbuster. I wanted to kind of show this life attitude, whatever that is. And I think we achieved that, and I'm really happy for this.
So I've noticed that the themes between wasteland and identity are so different, because you have that post-apocalyptic, very intense sensation on wasteland, but we move into a very digital age, very bright, very modern in identity. So how do you balance these themes with the music?
Well, wasteland was just like the epitaph for Piotr Grudziński. It was full of grief, full of melancholy, full of sadness. And the whole concept was mostly because, like, the end, this is like the end of the world for us, and now we should survive probably. But the mood, the atmosphere was really, you know, pretty gloomy, and like the cover, really rusty, really, you know. And that was 2018. After that, I was like the tour. Together with Maciej Meller, we created a different organism, different body, soul, and mind. And I thought that maybe it's time to show the Riverside right here, right now. After all these years, we have changed. We're a different band right now. So I really wanted to underline this. And I felt that it's time to do something, like to say goodbye to this, to this period of time with full of melancholy. I wanted to change something. I wanted to start over. The celebration of our 20 years of activity was full of melancholy and looking back. And now I wanted to look to the future. And okay, where are we now? Okay, here. So what's the perspectives? What do we have? What can we do now with our life? Okay, so that kind of questions were now on the table. That's why we have more about the future, about the present time. I was simply tired of melancholy and crying all the time, you know. I wanted to feel like there's still a bit of energy inside my body and mind, and let's do something with that together with the guys. So that was the main change. And I wanted to change also different things, like for the first time since I don't remember when, we have on the main album, we have the white background on the cover and lots of colors. Like the music, it's full of colors. We don't have the classic logo, Riverside, because I wanted to mark that we are starting something new. We have a different artwork artist, because it's not Travis Smith this time, it's Jarek Kubicki, Polish artist who did that. And we have official fourth member of Riverside, Maciej Meller, is now, you know, official. I was sad for him. So when we announced that, I remember during the fan club meeting, it was February 2020. Okay, guys, this is like the official fourth member of the band. And after that, COVID started, you know. So official member of the band had to be by himself alone in his own room. That was pretty sad. But so we were tired of this sadness, and we wanted to express our feelings in different way this time. Of course, talking about serious matters, about the, in the lyrics, we have subjects that probably everyone knows that they were important for me. And I was wondering about the style, because these lyrics are not very poetic, if you know. There's lots of direct words in there. But I just decided, okay, maybe I will keep my poetry for Lunatic Soul, and here I will be more direct, just to do some flashy words to take a photo of the times we live in right now. And I think that's why the identity is full of all these subjects and issues.
Yes, and so you've been talking so much about how this is really embracing Riverside as you are today and yourself as an artist. But at the same time, I see lyrical themes such as in The Place Where I Belong, about hiding your true self and covering up your true self. Do you feel that way personally? Is there anything that you still feel that you want to put into your art that you haven't yet?
Well, no matter what I do, probably I will be always in the same cage in many, many eyes. And I probably, for the first time, I just stopped struggling with that. I do what I can, you know, we mentioned at the beginning, where I have Riverside, I have a Lunatic Soul, I have my electronica world right now. But no matter what I do, I know that mostly the prog community will be into my music. I will not push some boundaries unless something happens, like, I don't know, my music will be on a new Netflix series, then probably someone else will hear that. But so far it's just like this. And I was struggling with that in the past. And now I just realized that, okay, so that's the world that I live in. So the place where I belong, for instance, has all these lyrics like, okay, maybe I can struggle with putting me to some cages that I don't want to be. But all in all, at the end, that's my place. You know, that's the place where I belong. I'm not sure if it's good or bad, but that's something that I should accept for sure. Not sure if I answer your question.
No, I mean, it's very poignant to put so much of yourself into your music like that, especially in a project where you are working with others. And I do see what you mean about some of them being direct. Like in Big Tech Brother, there is a very direct voiceover. How do you like to use voiceover in your music? Because this isn't the first time you've done that.
Well, actually, you know, Big Tech Brother, right? So we're talking about the capitalism of invigilation. And I even know from the very beginning that I'm not discovering anything new here. But I wanted to mark one thing, that everyone knows that we are followed, we are tracked, and everyone got used to this. But sometimes I believe we forget that other people can manipulate us, being a data. So we should always know that, you know, when it comes to Google search for the best barber in the neighborhood, that's fine. But when it comes to the new government election, we need to pay attention that someone can simply manipulate the fact that they know something more about us. So that was the main message about Big Tech Brother. And because of this invigilation, I wanted to use something like, you know, Siri or Alexa, just mark that. Maybe it's a bit cringy, but I like this idea very much. And I wanted to use the normal voice. And I wanted to use my voice, but my voice is not as good when I talk, you know, with this English accent. It would be like, okay, this guy is from different country, definitely. Maybe we should use Alexa and Siri. But I like this male voice. So I just wanted to mark one thing, that I didn't use male voice because I am huge patriarchate lover. No, not at all. I just felt it's connected with my voice when I use that in Loud My Blast, for instance. And then I use this terms and condition thing. I have some more ideas about it. When you have a artbook version, where before Big Tech Brother, you have also the message like, hello reader, if you want to see the next page, you must first agree to terms and condition, blah, blah, blah. This is something that you always do. So that's funny thing. I probably will do that during our live shows as well at the very beginning. So yeah, it was something new. That's simply something new and quite simple. I just used something that I found on my phone, you know, from the free app. And I said, wow, it's so easy. So I could pay someone to do that, but then I found it in the internet for free. So it was also very interesting to, on this album, to make that kind of move. It was a bit on purpose.
So with really unique elements like that, you were just mentioning you want to incorporate into the live show. What are you most excited about taking from this album and taking to the stage?
Well, I told you before that we composed this album with this live approach. Like, okay, let's create the album that sounds like we played a live album or something. So I'm afraid that this live aspect can be better on the album than during live shows, but I hope not. We just simply expect and pretty excited that these songs will sound really powerful live. They will have a second life, and then people will enjoy the album even more after attending to one of our shows. So yeah, it will be a very nice experiment. I'm really looking forward to feel that.
I am very much hoping to see you on whenever you come back to North America. I've had the privilege to see you a few times before, and it's always exciting. So from the bias of a fan, I am so excited. But touring is something that you do as a band very extensively. Is there any place in the world that you have not toured yet that you still want to?
Japan and Australia and New Zealand. Maybe we should push some boundaries before we die. And let's say, maybe, I don't know, it would be great to do something like that. But yeah, but there are also, you know, in the United States, we still have some places that we've never been to. So I hope we will visit these states. I'm really looking forward to start this tour in the United States, because that's always great energy. I'm not talking that because we're talking to each other right now, but I personally always feel great when I come to United States, because I feel this no pressure feeling, you know? And I really wanted to underline this feeling of no pressure on this album. Like even the attitude, even my approach to recordings was like, okay, I don't want to feel pressure. I don't want to record the best progressive album of all time. I want to have fun with these guys. So that was this approach, and I really like the final result, because you can feel that there's no pressure in music. Like, we just play, and there's this air and it flows. So during the tour, I believe that kind of songs will help very much, and especially when we start this tour in the United States. But I only hope that this winter that you had recently will be a bit softer, because I've heard that in mid states it's really rough. I'm not sure.
There are 3 feet of snow outside my window right now. So yes, it's
okay. Gotcha.
It's been a tough.
I know
one.
That. Yeah, the frost thing, like -30. That sounds really crazy. I hope that in February it will be like a bit cooler with this. I mean, not cooler. That's wrong, but you know, more smooth.
Oh, absolutely. And as a final question, just given how much work that you've done in the progressive community and other communities, and with this big new album release coming up, what would make you feel satisfied with this release? Would it be topping a chart? Would it be selling a certain number of albums? What are you looking for?
No, I said even in the lyrics to play Where I Belong that I'm tired of being the best. Feel pressure all the time, right? That we have these lyrics. So I don't care. I mean, I would lie if I'd say that, you know, would be nice to be on the charts, on the list, but come on, music is not a sport. This is not a competition. It's just like, I'm not always a huge fan of polls, because it's just like, usually who's on top? The guys who has the biggest fan base, and they have the biggest ranges on, I don't know, Facebook, social media. And, you know, because fans have to click this. So the more popular you are, you will be always somewhere on top, unless there are different rules. But I would like to maybe make people to think differently, some of them at least, because I would like to believe that there are some lyrics on the album that they can be important for someone. And there is still hope for us. Again, the album, the last song on the album is full of hope. And the main message is that we need each other. There's lots of people who want to antagonize us, but we need each other to make this world better. So we should start talking to each other with understanding, and to find a compromise in these places when it looks like it's not possible. I believe everything is possible, and but only we need to start to understand each other. That's the thing. So I wish myself to that someone will, after listening to this album, maybe he will do some first move to change something for better. That's my hope.
That's the hallmark of great art. And I fully believe this album is capable of that. It's very beautiful.
No, it's fine. The only people that we should unsubscribe are the toxic people that we really hate that are just not helping us to achieve what we can, what we would like to do, but the rest is fine.
Well, thank you again so much, and enjoy the rest of your evening. Have a wonderful day.
Thank you so much. The same to you.
Bye-bye.
See you on tour. Bye-bye.
Absolutely.